Well, thanks everybody for making it out to seminar today. Today we have the honor of welcoming Dr. Mikaela Provost, quantitative fisheries biology, giving a talk today on the sensitivity of populations in relation to climate change. So, without further ado,
thank you. Thank you. And thank you for the invitation to come. I'm really excited to be here. And I am a teacher, so I will project, but please raise your hand, just wave if you can't hear me, and I'll speak up. So I'm excited to talk to you today because I'm going to be sharing some of the research I've done recently that I completed. I just joined UC Davis in spring quarter, so in April, and I am so new faculty in the Department of Fish and Wildlife Conservation Biology. The work I'm showing you today is some work that I spent a lot of time thinking about from my PhD and postdoc, and also sharing you what I'm going to be doing in the future and building off of that work. So I call myself a quantitative ecologist who studies fish and fisheries using a combination of ecological theory and applied science. And the questions that interest me most focus on the response of harvested marine populations to environmental variability. And this cartoon time series on the top center represents some abundance of a marine organism through time. Could be a fish, an invertebrate. And the cartoon time series on the left is represents some aspect of the environment. Could be temperature, could be DO, dissolved oxygen. And I'm interested in this relationship and how the environment affects different marine organisms, because changes in abundance and variability in harvested populations directly affects management. And so that boat cartoon, that represents the management side of my research. And so my work focuses on different aspects of this framework. And I'll revisit this framework throughout the talk to show you how the different projects and research stories fit within this. So one thing that I find super interesting is that variability in fish populations is common. What causes populations to vary over time is a long-standing question in ecology as well as fisheries. And given the high variability in ocean conditions that occur at both long and short time scales, and how much is population variability driven by these extrinsic factors in the ocean versus intrinsic factors of the population itself? So the intrinsic versus intrinsic part of the variability is what interests me here. So I think this data set is super interesting. This is tuna cotton traps off the Sicilian coast dating back to the 1600s. And note that traps here refers to this complicated process of boats corralling tuna into an area of a bay with nets and then spearing the tuna. So it's not a physical trap, like a cage. And from this time series, right away, we notice there's both long-term variability and short-term, where you see the black line, the thin black line is very peaky. And then that smooth, thicker black line has this kind of longer-term variability over hundreds of years. So theoretical studies in ecology have helped us to understand that when the environment fluctuates, populations do not necessarily track environmental signal or the pattern in the environment. So this plot is showing you environmental conditions that's on the y-axis. I'm not giving you this particular variable in this case, but the conditions vary year to year through time. There are good years and there are bad years. And they're not correlated in this instance. This is white noise, good years and bad years in the environment just vary randomly. When you put a population of fish in this environment, we know that the fish populations do not track this noise signal in the environment, the white noise. So this is Pacific hake on the bottom plot over time. And you can think of egg production or some measure of abundance in the Pacific hake population. And we see that Pacific hake do not vary randomly in the way that the environment varies randomly. And we see that the population of hake filters environmental variability through its age structure. A lot of words I just threw at you. So we know that the majority of fish populations are age structured because typically fish in the ocean have distinct age classes or cohorts. They reproduce once per year, meaning, and then so that means that in a population, you'll have one-year-olds, you'll have two-year-olds, three-year-olds going up. And A good way to visualize the filtering of the environment through this age structure is to imagine a school that, like an elementary school or a junior high, with just four grade levels. So in this case, four grade levels, like a high school. And the number of incoming freshmen, you know, might vary year to year. And that variability is gonna transfer, like the number of freshmen one year might be high, so then the number of sophomores the next year will be high, juniors and seniors going up. And so the time it takes for the school of a high school to feel the effect of variability in freshmen is gonna take roughly 4 years. But if we have a school like an elementary school that has eight or six grades, or a junior high and elementary combined, which might have like seven grades, it's gonna take a lot longer for the changes in how many freshmen or first graders we enter into the school to filter through that whole population or that whole school. So the delay is gonna be longer in an elementary junior high situation, whereas in a high school, the variability in freshmen, that's gonna be a lot shorter. So the age structure is gonna matter here. This is similar to fish and marine ecosystems. So the environment has the most effect on the youngest fish in a population, age one. And depending on the age structure, how many age classes there are, some species respond quickly to environmental changes in that effect on age one, and some species don't respond quickly at all. They have a very lagged or damped effect response. And you can imagine this gets complicated when we talk about changes in the environment in our high school example, versus changes in the environment in our elementary, junior high example. And when we don't really know how many freshmen are coming in, because it can be quite variable in the environment. So you see that there's one other complicating factor with our school and our fish age structure, is that the number of freshmen that enter into school is actually a product of how many adults, you know, like freshmen are just randomly entering, but in a fish population, the number of baby fish is a function of how many adult fish are spawning. So the analogy breaks down there, but the whole point of this is that there's gonna be differences in age structure. Question.
Can you speak louder for the mic?
Oh yeah, there's no mic apparently. So I'll speak louder. That is your fault. I can compensate. Yeah, I appreciate you telling me. Yes, okay. So one of the questions that I spend a lot of time thinking about is which populations of marine fishes are sensitive to environmental variability, and which populations or species are insensitive. And by sensitive, I mean that if the environment has a good year, the population that is sensitive will respond favorably and population abundance will increase. And if environmental conditions are poor, then the population will respond to that and the population will decrease. An insensitive population does not track the environment as closely. So they're not gonna have a good year and bad year in the way that the environment might indicate. So I'm gonna go over this particular question will be one project I'm gonna share with you. And then the other project is gonna be building off of what I learned about sensitivity of populations to applications for management in the California current. And so differences in sensitivity to the environment is gonna play a role in how sensitive populations are to ENSO cycles. Because in the California current, ENSO cycles are the dominant mode of variability in the Pacific Ocean. Okay, so to get at what drives some species to be sensitive to long-term variability, short-term variability, what are we talking about? And the easiest way to visualize this is to consider a time series of cod dating back to 1920. I chose this time series because this population is very data rich and we know what's happening. We can use what we learn from cod to then test what's happening in other species. So the Skagerrak cod population is located between Norway and Finland down here, where that gray arrow is. And it dates back to the 1920s. And right away we see that there's both long-term variability, that's the green line, and short-term variability, that's the yellow line, or the yellowish orange. And previous work has shown that this pattern of variability where we have the the low frequency and then the high frequency variability, is a natural occurrence in age structure populations. In other words, this is not caused by the environment. This pattern variability is related to its age structure, in this case, cod, and filtering the background environmental noise. So the way that we quantify long and short-term variability here is with a frequency content plot. If you are an engineer, you are familiar with this plot. If you're not, I'm going to walk through this with you. So on the y-axis is variability in population size or abundance. And we're going to look at how much variability there is in response to environmental noise or environmental variability. On the x-axis is a range of different frequencies, ranging from long-term, so decadal, 50 plus years, very long-term variability on the near the zero on the x-axis, to short-term variability. So that's a 2-year 0.5 frequency equals 2 years period. And so if there's high variability over a 2-year period, that's like the line is really bouncing up and down over very short time intervals. So the unit on the y-axis is very useful here. It's useful because the area under this curve is the total variance in a time series. And you might wonder, why not just calculate the variance in COD? Like take the number of, you know, take that time series, calculate standard deviation or variance. Well, the shape of the curve tells us how much of, how tells us what timescales or frequencies contribute to the variation in that time series the most. So if that line is flat, then variability in population abundance is equal across all frequencies. And therefore, the population of COD would look like white noise. It does not. I'll tell you that now. And so here, the curved line, we see that there are two bumps, two peaks, and they occur at very low frequency or long time scales at that green arrow. And there's a bump at this yellow, the yellow arrow is pointing to a bump at around 2 to 3 years or 2.5 years. And that's the short time scale. And so here, what previous work has shown and that we've established is that populations in response to white noise environment, a population with age structure will vary at timescales roughly equal, the variability we dominated at very long timescales, so that's that low frequency, and at this 2 to 3 mark year mark for COD. And that 2 to 3 year mark corresponds to the generation time in this population of COD. So if we did the same analysis with, say, a rockfish, which lives to be 100 years old, the generation time for rockfish is much, much longer than for COD. And so that orange peak would actually be much further to the left because we're looking at a different generation time. I just want to take a step back here because there is one part that is really useful to have some intuition about when looking at these kinds of plots. So when we say there is an increase in variability at a specific frequency, which is at the green and the gold, what I mean by that is that at a particular frequency, say the three-year period, that's what that box on the right is showing. And we're gonna look at what is happening to a time series of abundance over a three-year period. If the frequency, or if the variability at that frequency increases, it looks like this in a time series of fish population, of fish abundance, such that the population of fish is gonna have much more booms and busts. Whereas if the variability is decreasing over that time period, we're gonna have a smaller peak on that frequency content plot. So is the variability due to fluctuating ocean conditions? The answer is no. There's a general pattern in age structure populations, and it means that populations will be sensitive to environmental change at certain time scales equal to their generation time. And what do I mean by sensitive? It is that when there's a good year, population is going to respond favorably. When there's a bad year, population will respond negatively. And if they're insensitive, they don't respond to that change in environmental conditions. This got me wondering, what determines when populations are more sensitive or high, or more sensitive to high or low frequencies in the environment? We know this is true for COD, but I want to know, this is one population of COD that this was shown in. can we figure out what is it about the aid structure that determines how much sensitivity you have? If the environment gets worse or better over short time scales, is that going to be good for the species or is it going to be bad? So I looked at 16 Atlantic cod stocks, and Atlantic cod are an ideal study system here to investigate this kind of question because they are super data rich. We've been studying them for 100 plus years. And they're useful also because each of these populations differ in their life history and their age structure. So these plots show just four populations as an example. On the x-axis is age, so age 0 to 25 here. And on the y-axis is a measure of how much does that age class contribute to spawning. And this gives us a sense of like, when is peak spawning age? How many age classes are contributing to reproduction? What is maximum age in the population? So there's different shapes, and the shapes refer to how wide or narrow those curves are. Yes, John. Oh yeah, why is that showing? Let's see here. All right, yep, thank you. All right, so there's differences in their age structure. That's good, because I'm testing out how does age structure affect sensitivity to the environment. All right, so to investigate how life history might influence sensitivity over long time periods, in other words, at low frequencies, that's that green box there, and over short time periods, in other words, at high frequencies, we use tools from theoretical ecology to examine how these depend on two important variables. Those variables are, first, is the slope of the stock recruit curve at equilibrium? So on the x-axis here is the number of adult spawning fish in a population. You might have a big population size or a small population size. Let's see if I can use my, here's big, lots of fish spawning, fewer fish spawning. And on the y-axis is recruits. So the number of baby fish produced from this, the number of spawning adults. And as populations get bigger, density dependence kicks in and they're stronger. So this curve will flatten out. And that's why we're gonna look at how strong is density dependence at these different. Dispens will be more or less strong at these different triangle points. I'm not gonna get into the details of why we think this is, but there's lots of evidence to suggest where a population sits on this density dependent curve is gonna have an influence on how sensitive a population is to the environment. The second, so just to show you, there's what I'm actually testing is these different places on the curve. And so you have steep versus shallow points. The other variable has to do with the shape of the spawning biomass distribution, those four examples I showed you earlier. And for shape, we look at two things. We are going to look at the ratio of the width to the mean spawning age, and we're going to look at maximum age in the population. So this is the one equation in the presentation. That's coefficient of variation. It's just describing how skinny or wide relative to peak spawning age. So we tested multiple variables that could be related to age structure. I'm showing you what matters most here. So first, we're gonna use our model to examine the influence of stock recruit curve position and that density dependence. So on that upper panel, it says steeper slope. And on the left where the number is smaller, the 0.15, very shallow slope. On the right where the number is 0.85, that's a very steep slope. So if we think a population has been harvested a lot to low population levels, we're considering a case where that 0.85 is relevant because the population is low. They're not experiencing a lot of density dependence because they're low on that curve. Whereas a population on the left has not had a lot of fishing pressure and there's lots of fish, that population is relatively larger. On the x-axis here, we're gonna look at changes in maximum age. So this first panel shows longer lived populations have higher variability at low frequencies. So longer lived, there's more variability at that low frequency, the green block. if we move down the stock or curve, so now the population is getting smaller because we're fishing that population down, we see that overall, in general, as you move down that stock recruit curve, meaning the slope gets steeper, these populations are associated with higher variability at low frequencies. And this is a very significant relationship. However, if we zoom in to each individual panel, the amount of variability at low frequencies depends on max age, but only at shallow slopes of the stock recruit curve. So only down on the left here does differences in age structure explain why some populations are going to be more sensitive to this low variability in the environment and versus others. If you have a bunch of populations that have been harvested way low, age structure doesn't matter as much anymore. And here they're all very sensitive to low frequencies in the environment. So now let's look at what influences the high variability or the variability at high frequencies. So that's that gold or the yellow part of the frequency content plot. So here's our longer, shorter. So longer, shorter refers to the time scale over which we're interested in figuring out what sensitivity a population has. So in this case, that 2 to 3 year mark could be as much as 5 years, depending on the age structure we're talking about. And again, the same panels as before. So here on the x-axis, we're looking at the shape of the spawning age distribution biomass. So this is that how skinny or how wide the age structure is. Do lots of ages contribute to spawning or just a few? What we find there is no relationship between the slope of the stock recruit curve and how sensitive populations are to variability at high frequencies. So I'll say that again. Doesn't matter if you're low on that curve or high on that curve. All populations are going to be, this does not influence how sensitive a population is to variability in the environment over short time scales. But if we zoom in to each individual panel, the influence of this coefficient of variation in our how peaked and how wide, here we find that variability at high frequencies over short time scales, this matters a lot. And so that species that are have smaller CVs are associated with increased sensitivity to environment over short time scales. Just a quick summary of what I just showed in these two plots. What increases sensitivity of populations at low frequencies? So this is 30, 40, 50 year time periods. The answer is how far on that stock recruit curve, how much density dependence there is in the population. What increases sensitivity to environment over short time scale, so like 2, 3, 4 years, it is that shape of the spawning biomass curve. So how many ages are contributing to reproduction? What is your peak spawning age? So what are the consequences of these findings? Well, it turns out that the probability of extinction depends on frequency-specific sensitivity. So on the y-axis here is probability of quasi-extinction. So this is a simulation test. So we're estimating not actually when species go extinct, but when they get to low enough levels where we predict that there's a very high chance they will go extinct. That's the quasi-extinction part. And so we do this by running a bunch of simulations with the environment being made up of white noise. And on the x-axis here is how much of a species sensitivity to the environment is in the low frequencies or in the high frequencies. So on the far left, on the far right, this caricature shows the yellow box being really big because that population is sensitive, more sensitive to variability at short time scales. Whereas the box on the left is the green box is relatively big. That means that populations over here are more sensitive to variability over long time scales. And we find that overall, the probability of quasi-extinction is higher in populations with greater sensitivity at low frequencies. That's where that circle is. And remember, low frequencies is that multi-decadal 30, 40, 50 year time scale. Why does this happen? Well, the basic explanation for what's going on here is that populations varying at high frequencies. Every couple of years, they're bouncing up, then bouncing down, bouncing up, bouncing down. Do not remain at low levels, population levels long enough to become extinct. They're only suppressed for a couple of years and then they bounce up. This is the classic sardine anchovy variability. Whereas rockfish populations, they don't have this boom bust, but they do have periods maybe for like 10 years where they're at very low population levels because they have that natural variability at low frequencies. Here is where they're more likely to go extinct because they are suppressed at low levels for many years in a row. And there happens to be a bad recruitment year and another bad recruitment year. And so there's just more chances for something to go wrong. All right, that was story number one. And that story number one probably took me 3 years to figure out. And I was like, okay, this is very deep in theoretical ecology. I really wanted to tie this into some applied management questions. What can we learn from this for people who are trying to manage fish? And so that's what I'm excited to show you here about this part is getting into California fisheries and fisheries management. And so far I've been talking about variability in the ocean in response, variability in fish populations in response to environmental variability in the ocean as being made up of as white noise. So this is like saying everything in the ocean is random, which I'm sure John is thinking, no, it's not. There are definitely things that are correlated. And in the California current, this is very true. We know that the environment is not random. It is dominated in particular with ENSO cycles. And so everyone here is probably familiar with ENSO cycles, but in case you're less familiar, this is a shift in generally in ocean temperatures that flips between a cool phase and a warm phase. And each phase can last a decade, roughly, less or more. So some species favor warm conditions and some species favor cool. And this pattern of environmental variability is clearly not white noise. So everything I've showed you has been with white noise. But when we try to apply this, we need to consider other types of noise in the environment. So remember, white noise is this not correlated year to year. That's what this time series is showing you here. When doing these modeling exercises, this is a good approximation to start with if you don't know what your environment looks like. ENSO variability peaks every 5 to 6 years. That's when the flip happens from a cool to a warm. Ocean environments are changing rapidly every 5 to 6 years. If ENSO cycles become more frequent, then variability will peak every 2 to 3 years, for example. And if ENSO cycles slow down, then variability peaks every 10 to 12 years. And so some work in focusing on how, like, talking about how ENSO cycles are changing with climate change suggests that how frequent ENSO cycles occur is going to change in the future with the idea that they're going to become more frequent. So there's a question of how much of a difference does the environmental noise make when in management of overfishing for California current species. So to answer this question, I looked at 12 species managed by the Pacific Fishery Management Council, and they all range in longevity. So some are long-lived and many have many age classes that contribute to reproduction and some are shorter-lived. And the Pacific Fisheries Management Council takes a very precautionary approach to how they set catch limits or the fishing rates that they set for a population to minimize the risk of overfishing. They can't guarantee that overfishing won't happen, but they just try to reduce the chances of it. And so to do that, they set different levels and they account for uncertainty in different ways. So imagine this bar here represents the possible catch in 1 year. So the OFL, this is the overfishing limit, is the theoretical max the population can withstand without being overfished to maintain sustainability. However, just in case scientists get their population models wrong, which has happened, they set the allowable catch just a little bit lower. And that's the ABC, allowable biological catch. And just in case fishery managers have difficulty in knowing when the fishery has met the target, because there's a delay in when fishermen are catching fish, landing, reporting that landing, then gets put into a stock assessment, they add even more buffer. So that's the annual catch target. So the take-home message here is that buffers are added because there is uncertainty in the fishery. And one question that I have gotten thinking about is, does the buffer need to be larger if ENSO in the environment, if we model populations with ENSO signal instead of white noise? And what if ENSO cycles speed up? Do we need to have a larger buffer? So the next few plots will look like this. So I just want to walk through an example plot. The squiggly line is the population biomass over time. And this population has been fished at its target set rate by managers. And the flat line is the overfishing limit. So if we had fished this population at the max rate, the OFL line, this would be the mean level. So if basically in a year where that squiggly line is below the overfishing limit, we would say that population is overfished. Anytime that squiggly line is above that line, we would say the population is good to go and you can continue to fish. So the probability of exceeding the OFL, the overfishing limit, is the fraction of that time the squiggly line is below the OFL. So we're looking at how often does that squiggly line dip below that flat line. So when NOAA assesses their fish stocks, they assume the environment is white noise. And my work here is showing, well, what happens if we change that assumption and we incorporate ENSO variability into their population models. So I'm going to walk through just two species here and not all the whole set, because it will get it's a lot of plots. So let's look at two case studies. This is Pacific sardine, and which has a maximum age of roughly 15 years, and dark watch rockfish. And they can have a max age of about 105 years. And for sardines, overfishing happens 18% of the time with white noise. The exact number here is not important. But what is important is how this number changes with different noise signals and how it compares to other species. So that number jumps to 31% if we change the environmental noise signal to what ENSO cycles have been historically. In dark watch rockfish, we see that it jumps from 0.02 to 0.06 in an ENSO environment. Overall, what this is for all the species is plotted here in this plot. So on the y-axis is the probability of overfishing. And each species is plotted with a green triangle and a pinkish salmon colored circle. The triangles are ENSO environmental noise. Overall, overfishing is way more likely to occur when the environment looks like ENSO compared to white noise. What happens if we expect ENSO to slow down or speed up? So by slow down, I mean the cycles become spread out. So peak variability is at 10 to 12 years. Speed up means ENSO is flipping much more frequently. We do a similar analysis. I'm not going to walk through each circle here, but I'm going to skip to the main plot here. So again, on the y-axis is probability of overfishing. And we see that there's a higher chance of overfishing if ENSO slows down. So the purple triangles is ENSO slow. The blue circles are the ENSO fast. So what we expect to occur in the future with climate change, ENSO speeding up. In fact, if ENSO speeds up, so there's a higher chance of overfishing if ENSO slows down, but if ENSO speeds up, which is what we expect to occur based on climate and oceanographic models, the probability of overfishing for most of these species actually decreases. This suggests that it's possible management could loosen restrictions and increase allowable catch. That is a bit controversial to suggest, because this is suggested there might be a brighter story, but based on some models. So, okay. Some conclusions, just to quickly wrap up this section. Is the probability of overfishing larger if the environment is ENSO instead of white noise? For which species? Yes, for all species. ENSO noise could be an important source of uncertainty in fishery models. If ENSO speeds up, will the probability of overfishing increase? No, compared to historical frequencies of ENSO. ENSO speeding up, the probability of overfishing is actually expected to decrease. Okay, so these sorts of modeling exercises and studies, I'm starting to think about future directions. I won't get into them here, but it's expanding it to more species in more places around the world using the RAM Legacy database, which is a database of all the stock assessments that are done in the world in a standardized way. I've also started to think about how this work is incorporated into climate vulnerability assessments. I'm co-leading the climate vulnerability assessment for CDFW in partnership with many other people. And so there's some trying to figure out which species are going to be sensitive to climate change and not. The last story I just want to share with you before we end, I'm really excited about this project. And this is focused on climate change habitat refugia. And my interest in the environment, populations, fisheries really came together in this project centered on abalone based in Baja California, Mexico. I started this work during my postdoc right before coming to Davis at Hopkins Marine Station with Julio DeLeo and Fio McKelly and Brock Woodson at University of Georgia. So as many, all of us here know, abalone in California have declined in major ways, mostly because of overharvest, but also because of big changes in the environment, big stresses. And in Mexico, the populations of abalone are doing comparatively better. And Mexican fishery managers have seen what California has done and want to avoid the mistakes of California. And they are very interested in understanding how does the environment affect abalone populations and what can we do about it? And so they started thinking about like what aspects of the environment is impacting abalone. And out of those conversations, we've started talking about climate change refugia. And these are areas that are buffered from climate change relative to their surroundings. And this is of increasing interest in marine spatial managers, spatial management, as they seek to prioritize, you know, can we make marine reserves or other forms of spatial management climate resilient? And that's really tough when spatial management is fixed. You can't move things. And so although climate change refugia is frequently identified as a key adaptation strategy, knowing what constitutes a habitat refuge is a significant challenge, in part because there have been so many different studies approaching this question from different perspectives. So just to nail the point, there's many definitions floating out there, but refugia here in this case is along a coast, say the California coast, because there's variability in coastal oceanography, what parts of the coastline are changing less over time compared to other areas? Where are those pockets that are slower? We would call them the slow lanes of climate change. So this project is really trying to tackle the idea of how can insights from multiple field observations and experimental studies be used to identify areas of coastline that are buffered from climate change and therefore might have lower environmental stress. So in this, we focus on green abalone because they're an important fishery in Baja. And we focus on temperature as a key characteristic of habitat refuge because there's very good evidence of how temperature affects abalone. As with many other coastal regions, ecosystems and fisheries along the Pacific, they've been hit by many extreme events are a common occurrence and especially driven by climate change. So marine heat waves in the past have played a big role in abalone mass mortality events. And we think that abalone may benefit big time from thermal refuges because they don't move very fast or very far and have shorter or smaller dispersal distances. So the question is, how can we define a thermal refuge? And do they even exist is the second part of this. So over the past few years, what I didn't say when I had my intro slide when I got involved in this project, I'm definitely building on work, data, relationships that have been built for over 20 plus years. So what I'm showing you is not work that I have done in alone. This is definitely a huge effort to collect this data and then put together this analysis. So when I say temperature loggers were deployed, that was not me. That was many, many other people. So we're focusing in on this part of Baja, and we're focusing on that part because this is where there are fishing cooperatives that have been established. These are the gray polygons. These are management zones that have management autonomy. They manage their species from the bottom up. This is opposite from how the US manages fish. We have an agency in DC that tells each part of the US how to manage. It is completely opposite right in Mexico for Baja. In each of these cooperatives, temperature loggers were deployed for over a few years and recording temperatures at pretty high intervals, I think 10 minute intervals over 2 or 3 years. So using this data through lots of discussions and brainstorming, we figured out that there are three possible ways based on the literature from marine physiologists, from ecologists and oceanographers that abalone will experience thermal stress. And it's when we can look at when temperature varies a lot. The first definition is when temperature varies a lot over short time periods, and we call this short-term variability. So here's a two-week snapshot of yearly temperature, of 2 weeks of a year time series of temperature for in one of these locations. And for abalone, the period we're talking about over a short term is roughly 4 days. And we chose 4 days because experience have shown that when temperature changes over this time frame rapidly, abalone can stop feeding, can stop moving around, and both are signs of stress. If abalone are exposed to temperature that doesn't change very rapidly, but it does get warmer, the stress level is much lower, and so they can acclimate to that sort of temperature, even if it's very warm. So using a 4 day moving window, we can look at how much variability there is in temperature over this to measure thermal stress. And the way that we measure this is the difference between expected temperature and experienced temperature. So expected temperature is the acclimatized temperature, which is based on what the abalone experiences today and over the past 3 days. But the temperature today matters more. So we weigh that temperature more heavily when calculating the expected temperature, as indicated by that circle size. Fitting a linear regression here, we using the weights from those temperatures, we can calculate the acclimatized temperature, which is the red star. So based on what you experienced recently, you were acclimating to your experience, you expect the temperature to be a certain temperature today. The difference between the expected and experienced is stress. And that's shown visually here with the green arrow. So for each day we do this, looking at the past 3 days to calculate the expected temperature and take the difference between the actual experienced temperature. And with this method, we can generate a time series of stress. So this is the same 2 week snapshot I showed you earlier, converted to abalone daily stress. And the points, the further the points are from that dashed line means that the experienced temperature was a lot farther off from the expected temperature, so more stress. And the colors just indicate the absolute value of temperature that day. So in this definition of thermal stress, we're assuming that the absolute value of temperature doesn't contribute to stress, right? There are different assumptions. I'm going to get into those next here. So to compare the stress at this location with other sites, we take the integral of this curve and use absolute values. Okay, that was one way to define thermal stress. The second way is by using this notion of examining thermal extremes or thermal thresholds. And again, we start with the same time series of temperature. This time the definition, this concept is similar to degree heating weeks, which is used to measure thermal stress in corals. So here we select a warm thermal threshold, say 20 degrees C, and sum the degrees experienced above that threshold. This approach is used in other species, including corals. So daily temperature is equal to the degrees experienced above that threshold. And we can sum those up and take the interval of that curve. The last thermal stress definition comes from marine physiology. And this is based on what a thermal performance curve is. And so this uses the idea that thermal, that if you're unfamiliar with this curve, I realize many of you are familiar with this, but I'll walk through it anyway here. Organism metabolic performance is highest at some intermediate temperature, and that when temperature becomes really cool or really warm, metabolic performance goes down. And we assume that thermal stress increases at temperatures both extreme, both at the cool end and the extreme, the warm end, at both extremes. And so with that assumption, we take a thermal performance curve and flip it to get a measure of thermal stress. So instead of metabolic performance on the y-axis here, it is now a measure of thermal stress. So stress is highest at cool temps and at warm temps, and is lowest at these intermediate temps. So we used equations and parameters published in synthesis papers to calculate general performance curves. Because we are not actually interested in calculating metabolic performance, but instead assume the curve explains a measure of relative stress experienced at different temperatures, we borrowed parameters from similar species to create a curve that is site specific. So site meaning at each location where we have a record of time series temperature. So one big assumption of our model is that abalone experienced some local adaptation in that the peak, the temperature at peak performance is going to vary from one site to another site because abalone experienced a different regime, a temperature regime at these different sites. So using these three definitions, we analyze a time series of daily ocean temperature. And we do this along the entire Baja coastline at every 1 kilometer stretch. That's almost 1,000 kilometers. And you might be wondering, wait, where did you get time series of ocean temperature on the seafloor where abalone live every 1 kilometer? In case you weren't wondering, you should be wondering that, because that's pretty wild. So I won't get into all the details here, but what we were able to do is we had those temperature loggers at those 18 sites on the bottom. So it's recording what is temperature where abalone are experiencing. They're in their habitat. We have sea surface temperature from satellites every 1 kilometer. And we were able to create a conversion that takes sea surface temperature and correct it for what ocean temperature at the bottom should look like for abalone. If there are questions about this, I have additional plots to show you what I mean by a correction. But here in this plot, this is the orange line is the temperature from a temperature logger. So it was actually measured. The blue line is the sea surface temperature from satellites. They're very similar, but not the same. And so we were able to capture how much variability is occurring in the bottom, convert it. Can we convert variability from the top and convert it to what variability at the bottom would look like, in addition to this climatology, the low frequency variability. This map is kind of showing you a big sum of all of that different thermal stress definitions and work here. So we're almost done here. This is the last part of it. So yellow means low stress, and you could think of this as a safe space for abalone. Darker color means higher environmental stress or higher thermal stress. Places that have low thermal stress based on all three definitions, we call them consistently safe. We don't really know how to define what thermal stress is in abalone. We have information from these different studies, right? Oceanography study, marine heat wave studies, experiments in tanks, and we combine all three to look at, well, doesn't matter how you define thermal stress, where is it showing up as consistently safe? And we've roughly found there's like 18% of the coastline that falls into this category. This sort of approach is trying to reduce the uncertainty or account for the uncertainty that we have in understanding how a species is experiencing stress in the environment and incorporating multiple definitions. But this is all really great, but one really important part of this story is explaining, does it match up with spatial variability in abalone? Is there more, which stress definition is explaining variability in abalone abundance? And so to do this, we had used a case study around an island in one of the cooperatives. So that gray polygon, I'm gonna zoom in onto one island here. This is Isla Natividad. And we use catch per unit effort around Isla Natividad to get at, can variability in environmental stress explain variability in abalone catch? We understand that CPUE is not always a good measure of abalone abundance, but it's the best we have. And we think this is actually a good representation of abundance, even though it is data from fishermen. So the color boxes indicate management zones around the island. And note that the y-axis here is CPUE, the x-axis is year. We're going from 1995 to 2010. And in that time period, there was a big El Nino event. So we have to account for that in our analysis here. So each plot is showing CPUE in these different zones. The dashed lines show when the El Nino started in 97 and ended in 2000. And the flat line before and after showing what is the mean catch before and after that El Nino event. The color bars show that mean CPUE in some zones changed a lot after the El Nino, but not everywhere. So the abalone were hit hard by El Nino, but in some regions, they seem to be more resilient. C zone B, there's much less of a difference there. So we also calculated thermal stress around this island here. And we questioned which thermal stress definition best explains abalone variability. And does it explain it even with this big El Nino event? So to do this, we developed some mixed effects linear models to explain how variability and CPUE is changing. And there are a few variables that help explain variability. It is CPUE, so it is gonna be before or after an El Nino event. We included what fishing zone, maybe some fishing zones tend to have more productivity than others. And we also included our, anyway, some zones are also gonna be stronger, weak upwelling. We want to account for that variability. So in the end here, we found that around Isla Natividad, the model with stress defined as exposure to thermal extremes. So that was stress number definition number two, explained approximately 70% of CP of catch per unit effort in abalone around the whole island. And that by far was a lot better at explaining variability compared to the short-term variability, which was stress definition number one, which explained only 30% of variability. And the model with the least power at explaining variability was the thermal performance curve. So my last slide here, some takeaways. This work is definitely ongoing and not done. And there are three major benefits, I think, to how we've developed our methods. First is that the framework we've designed for these three definitions of thermostress can be tailored to different species. Second, the definitions are based on physiological and ecological principles, how species acclimatize, adapt, and what their physiological limits are. And third, these methods are straightforward and can be applied. So there, it is hopefully not too black boxy, but very mechanistic. With all of that, there are three major cautions. As we've defined them here, climate change habitat refuges are not indications of where there will be high abundance of species. They might be, but really they should be interpreted as places where organisms are likely to persist when environmental conditions change at broad scales. And the type of thermal stress, in this case, we had three definitions that explain species of persistence will likely change within geographic regions because organisms are exposed to different types of coastal oceanography. So maybe they're more adapted to extreme conditions or short-term variability. And as with any sort of predictive method, we are working to gather more abalone survey data. This is definitely the limiting factor here to validate, actually, can we test, make to check whether abalone are responding to these different definitions of stress. Okay, and with that, I will answer questions if there is time, and thank you so much. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great question. And if I had another hour, I would. The shortest answer to that is that, so some species or populations are sensitive to certain frequencies in the environment because of their interest. So certain frequencies, meaning sensitive to frequency, to variability that occurs over, say, 2 to 3 years. And some species are not. These species are sensitive to frequencies in the environment at lower frequencies, so like, say, 7 years. So when variability in the environment starts increasing at every 2 to 3 years, those populations are insensitive to that. And they don't actually respond to that sort of increasing variability because they're more sensitive to variability that occurs at longer timescales. Yeah, that was a good question. Yeah.
I think that's like a more general and broad question in the sense that earlier the model worked with it. And so are you talking about any type of ENSO? You know, there's a lot of variability in ENSOs.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. No, that's so things that I did not test was like intensity of ENSO. So if whether upwelling becomes way more stronger or weaker. That is different from what, so I was looking at how, when does it occur over time? So like how frequently it happens. And the way that this is in the model, it is assuming that ENSO has either a overall positive or negative effect on age one fish, on recruits. And so if the environmental conditions tend to be, it is all playing out in that age one survival rate. And if the environmental conditions tend to favor age one, then that's gonna be whatever that, in, so if ENSO is, so like I mentioned, there are warm affiliated and cool affiliated species. I'm not explicitly testing which species are warm and which are cool. I'm only looking at which ones are gonna be, are gonna experience a boom or a bust, no matter if it's going to be a warm or a cool, just in conditions change that year. And so it's kind of like saying, but going back to that high school example with the age class, like freshman entering here, I'm like, okay, in this time series of random environmental noise, okay, the number of freshmen entering is going to be, it's going to be like on average, very good. So there's going to be tons of freshmen entering into the school. And it's gonna, when, and then there'll be a period where the number of freshmen entering into the school is pretty bad. And how long or how quickly that changes from a good year of freshmen entering to a bad year, that is what, that's how ENSO is factoring into here. So we're like, okay, if ENSO, if that change happens every 3 years or every 10 years, and that's the way it's all playing in at that age one. I'm not sure if I answered your question, but.
Yeah, no, I think so.
Okay.
Are you only talking about intense ENSO?
No. Oh, I am talking about, I'm not testing out intensity. So it is like, it is any event and it's going to be, I'm assuming. And so in our models where we have created noise signals for the environment based on historical frequency of ENSO. So, and that's going to be based on like, I'm not testing out, okay, this year, 1980, was it a good or a bad year? It is a simulation of the composite variability. So what is the variability that we see? So on average, ENSOs are, and I can build a time series model that incorporates that average variability, but not testing out specific years and their intensity. Yeah, I think intensity is a big missing part of that project. Because there, I think there's gonna be different effects of like, okay, if freshmen increase this year, but by like 5 times as much, like if recruitment booms really big versus recruitment booms just a little bit. Like, I think that that was a separate study, but I think that's a big, a missing part of that project. Yeah, great question. Yes, John.
That's what people think about. Two studies, two fisheries,
stated that this kind of we can see the middle of is that historically based or is that just that kind of convenience?
The way I those character pictures is a little bit of a simplification. So in the actual model, I was calculating the sensitivity at high and low, and the cutoff is based on generation time. And so so for each species or population, it was what is the generation time? That's the cutoff, or a little bit to the left of that. But yeah, that's the cutoff for what is considered high and low. I did like vary that a little bit to see how much the results would change. It didn't change that much, mostly because these species tend to just be really sensitive to low frequencies in the environment. So you'd have to change it a lot to figure out what is considered low frequency to get a bigger portion, a fraction at high frequencies. Yeah. No, it's fine. Yeah, that's a good question. We have evidence of it at a much smaller scale than all of Baja. So in the cooperatives, they've definitely documented, I don't want to say marine heat wave because I know there's a definition of that, but like periods of intense warming, mass mortality events of various critters. And they know that because they've been monitoring the same places over time. And then fishermen who are harvesting notice these changes. So I can't say for sure. We don't have a study that's like, oh, this is exactly how it's changed over the past decade or two decades, but yeah.
Again, that's the more complex issue. I guess my concern always is I'm working in estuaries quite a bit. In existence, you do want stress.
Yeah.
Because that's what gives you biodiversity.
Yeah.
Sensitivity and genes.
Yeah.
So if you respond by putting NPAs in those zones,
yeah, I think that's a really, really good point. And it all comes into like, what is your definition of a refuge? The Baja Project really, they didn't come up with the term refuge. They were focused on this term of safe space. I think that because they had witnessed there are just no more abalone around this island. Like, and we went back year after year, something stressful happened. It was probably, I agree. We don't want to have no stress, but figuring out what are those limits and what is building adaptive capacity? What is actually just exceeding that by too much? And I'm still a little bit skeptical about, do they even exist? this is much easier to look at an invertebrate that doesn't move around that much, but when you're talking about fish that do move, does it even there? It's a little bit more nuanced to talk about refugia. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, well, no, I don't. Well, if there's any more questions afterward, I'll be at lunch, but also just email me. Happy to chat more. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks,
Rachel. Oh, there's one chat. Is there something on the chat? Okay. Maybe I wasn't sure. Yeah. Mm. Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. We tried to combine.
I think I see what you're talking about. Like, we had trying to figure out a way to combine short-term variability with and we had come up with a way to do that. But you really wanted to verify that, like, because right, we're back calculating up. So we did this like temperature to bottom temperature conversion. And you want to make sure that whatever stress value is calculated using the actual temperature versus the amount of heat. And that's what this file is showing. And so the when we